before we dive into the nitty-gritties of marketing measurement, just a look at how measurement has progressed over the years. This is a view of how channels have proliferated across multiple decades. And you will see that at every point, marketers try to grapple with each new channel that came into play. And by the time you had a metric that you thought defined that particular channel, you had something else that came in, right? And now, if you look at where we are today around 2016, 2017, you have a bunch of offline media, you have a lot of digital channels, and these channels are adding day by day. And by the time you create a metric to measure one channel, you have another channel that's very different and unique, and you need to create a new metric, right? So the question is, what are we doing at Facebook to help marketers measure effectively? So we are saying move away from intermediary metrics and focus on real outcomes that matter to you, and also measure across everything. Don't just focus on one channel. Create a measurement framework that allows you to measurement across everything. And we'll talk a little bit more about how Facebook is helping facilitate some of that. One of the big problems you'll see is that you have no common denominator for measurement across channels, right? So you have GRPs for TV, you have something for desktop that doesn't work for mobile, you have something for in-app now. So the problem is that each of these are kind of siloed metrics, and as a marketer, you're not able to measure metrics across the board. So this is an important slide because this talks about our philosophy at Facebook. And if you look back at how Facebook was built as a social media platform, at the core of the platform, we had the identity of a unique user. So people had to trust that you were who you were before they started a social interaction with you. So all of the infrastructure that Facebook was built on was built around the concept of unique identity. So you are who you are regardless of if you log in on your app or your mobile or your website or your desktop. Probably Facebook is the one platform that best allows a marketer to identify a unique user in an accurate manner. So this is very useful from a marketing construct, because as you speak to different publishers, the single biggest challenge, and I'll talk about some data, the single biggest challenge is that you're not able to uniquely identify a user to be able to target them well and hence measure outcomes. So all of our measurement platforms that I'll talk about are built around this concept of unique identity on people. So we call our measurement stack people-based measurement stack. Just some data, and this is done with third-party providers such as Nielsen, and it covers a variety of number of studies that we did in the US. And you could argue that the desktop versus mobile thing is more prevalent in the US than it is in India. But even in India, if you look at certain categories like travel, you see a lot of cross-device activity. So you see people are searching a lot on mobile and then going and buying a desktop. It's true for high-value items. It's true for a bunch of categories, including for fashion, where we see a lot of browse behavior on the mobile, and they go and buy on desktop. Now, the problem with measuring on desktop, and as people move to mobile, was that the desktop measurement is based on cookies. And it's not always extremely accurate for a bunch of reasons, which we won't get into here. Versus the measurement stack that we use depends on people. So we don't, once we put in a pixel and an SDK, a pixel in a desktop and an SDK in an app, we're able to uniquely identify a user. And regardless of how you traverse across these multiple platforms, including your tablet or your mobile or your desktop, we're able to uniquely identify a person. So what happens when you do that? So when you use cookie-based measurement, but you actually reach the same person twice. So what you end up doing is you overstate reach. And then what also happens is you understate frequency. So you believed you reached one person twice, but you actually reach them only once. So you understate frequency, you overstate reach. The other challenge, like I said, is you're not able to target audiences because demographic data, age, gender, all of that is not very accurate and not available for a lot of digital publishers, unlike the data that Facebook has. So if you kind of benchmark all of this across a bunch of studies that we did with Nielsen, and this is US data, and we can easily replicate this to India, we see there's a lot of overstatement of reach, understatement of frequency, and gap in age and gender targeting. Channels like Facebook, channels like display, work through the funnel. So you have multiple views, multiple interactions with the consumer before they ultimately click and possibly buy your product. So And this is extremely high when your mobile spends on mobile advertising is higher. So we saw about 54% misattribution because of last click in the US. And it's an extreme case when they have high mobile spends, but typically it's in the range of 20 to 25% in terms of misattribution. The other thing to note, and again, this is off Facebook data, is that typically in digital marketing, we tend to go after clicky users. So everybody is optimizing their platforms to chase the people who are likely to click more. So what tends to happen is when you have auction-based systems such as Facebook, they tend to become more expensive because more people are chasing the same clicky customers. So what happens is that you have a bunch of customers that are online that are very clicky, but not necessarily the ones who are most likely to buy a product. But you're paying a premium to reach those people. And what ends up happening is you ignore a bunch of customers that are not so clicky, but are cheaper, probably more likely to buy your product, but you're not targeting them. So we'll talk a little bit about what is it that, what is the business metric that you want to drive, and what is the input metric that you want to use as a targeting metric, right? So if you look at this chart, about 10% audience, 5.5x the cost, are your most clicky. And then 50% audience, the most cost-effective, are not clicky, but you're not targeting them because you're not optimizing on clicks. So all of the dots that you see in blue are individual measurement tests that were done to track each of these metrics. So you have ad recall, brand awareness, purchase intent, right? And if you try to correlate the outcomes on hundreds of these studies and plot it against click-through rates, so here we're trying to see if click-through rates actually predict any of these brand metrics that you as an advertiser are interested in. So initially we talked about not focusing on likes and metrics, but focusing on brand metrics such as these. And now we're saying if you plot click-through rates, do they correlate? The answer is no. So if you as a brand advertiser chase people who are more clicky, thinking that they're more likely to kind of convert and drive outcomes, that's not necessarily true. Because you find these brand metrics are not driven by clicks alone. So the question is, what do we do at Facebook? So one is we focus on people, like I said. We focus on real outcomes, and we focus on measuring impact across channels. And we'll talk about how we accomplish that using Facebook and other third-party partners that we have. So the data that we have, I'll just pause to kind of take a minute, and this is getting updated by the hour and by the month. We obviously have billions of users across the globe. We have a lot of data around demographic, geographic, behavioral interests, and so on, which we use in the measurement stack. So there are principally three types of outcomes that we seek to measure. So one is audience outcomes, which is basically the input data that you as a marketer are interested in to make sure you're targeting the right people. Then we have brand outcomes to make sure that you're acting on top of the funnel, making people aware of the brand and getting them to move down the funnel. And then you have sales outcomes. So if you look at the stack of offerings that we work with marketers on, we have three distinct categories of products and services that we offer. And the important thing to note is we just don't say measure us, measure on and off Facebook. So we have a relative and a comparative view. And we actually enable third parties, and we have tools that we are developing as we speak that help you measure marketers by using our people-based identity as a core of the platform. So I'll spend a few minutes on what we're trying to answer with each of these types of tools. We have a bunch of solutions that seek to answer the question, am I reaching the right people? Right. So you have a lot of ad fraud going on there. You also have this issue of not being able to target to your right audience in terms of age, gender, and so on. So we have a bunch of solutions that help you measure whether you're reaching the right people. Did you reach people across multiple devices? And how do you optimize for reach versus frequency? So the other challenge that you have is when you're using multiple media, both offline and online, is how do you make sure that you're reaching different audiences and you're not bombarding the same audience through multiple channels? So audience measurement tools help you kind of get a fix on your input metrics. So a few of the tools that are available on the Facebook platform, if you're an advertiser, you have access to a bunch of tools around ads reporting, which gives you a lot of metrics around reach, frequency. You can plan your campaigns. There are a lot of audience insights that you can generate. Just as a normal Facebook user, you can go and slice and dice your data by different demographic cards, interests, likes, and so on. So a lot of tools that we have. We also have something called split testing, which allows you to run split testing across different campaigns. So you could test for different creatives, you could test for multiple ad inputs using a typical A/B testing methodology. We also have a bunch of partners we have enabled. So one of the principal ones are Nielsen DAR. So Nielsen DAR, what it does is, it uses the, we have enabled Nielsen to have access to our, you know, people-based identity in a privacy-safe manner. What they do is, they kind of benchmark that people-based data using their own internal tools. So they actually take it to 100% accuracy by running a sample of identity checks on the raw data that we give them. And then they use this identity data to map accuracy of reach and frequency, age and gender targeting across publishers. So if you're running a major campaign using multiple digital publishers, what Nielsen will do is they'll run a check through the campaign, and they'll verify the accuracy of these impressions that you're serving on an age and gender. So if you're doing narrow targeting, so a certain segment of male, female, age, you're able to get a report that benchmarks Facebook and other publishers based on the unique identity that Facebook helps them to get to that accurate level of reporting. So we do that. We also have a number of viewability partnerships enabled. So we have Moat, we have IAS, so that allow you to do a third-party validation of the kind of impressions you're serving both on Facebook and off Facebook. I'll talk a little bit about Lyft. I think the headline is hidden. So this is at the core of our marketing philosophy, and I'll spend a minute explaining how it works and how we deploy it. So as a marketer, if you're running an advertisement on TV, and you probably have a brand track that's running that's capturing what that campaign did for you in terms of metrics, right? So what you're able to do is you're able to measure the impact of a campaign over a period of time. And it's very hard for you to isolate the specific impact of what the incremental outcome that you draw. So if I didn't do the campaign versus if I did the campaign, what would have been different? It's very hard for you as a marketer to measure. Now, with digital, you have the advantage that you're able to control your impression at an individual level. So you know who you have served the impression to, and you know who you haven't served the impression to. So it's possible in a digital world, with the people-based identity such as the one that Facebook offers, to very scientifically measure the true incremental impact of your advertising, and you can do that through the funnel. And I'll talk about how the concept works. So if you look at the blue blocks as, you set off all your customers, right? And they are bombarded with TV, they have print, they have search, they have everything going on in there. So what we do is we randomly split your audience. So we have at the bottom what we call a control, and we kind of have a test group which is exposed to Facebook advertising. So everything is similar across these two audiences. The only difference being that the test was exposed to Facebook advertising, right? The FB on the square box is Facebook advertising. Now we randomize at two levels. So before a campaign runs, the entire Facebook universe is split into these two groups, regardless of which campaign is running. So you have an identifier that randomly splits these two groups. And then when the ad is served, the auction engine looks for two people that are very similar to each other. And we kind of make sure that the person who served the ad in the test, you have an equivalent person in the control group who's very similar across the millions of attributes that we capture, but has not served the ad. And if you run a report post the brand lift test, you can actually get a distribution of both the tester and the control. You'll see that the age distribution, the gender distribution, and any other parameter that you'll want to measure by are exactly the same for these two groups. Now, what we say is that any metric that you measure on the test versus that you measure on the control, the only difference between the two groups, because they're very similar people, is that one was exposed to Facebook advertising, one wasn't. So any outcome that you see that's different, and that's statistically significant and measurable, is due to Facebook. So, and that's the concept of Lyft. So what we do is, now the good part about this is you can measure through the funnel using polling. So you can look for brand awareness, consideration, purchase intent, and so on. And then you can also measure sales, because in a digital world, especially for online businesses, you're able to pick the signal back in terms of all events that the consumer performed on your website, right? So you have, did they view the content? Did they add to cart? Did they buy a product? So you can actually look for incremental outcomes across control and Lyft in the same campaign. So, this is a marketer's delight, right? So if you're an online company and you want to measure the outcome of a campaign, and you're saying through the funnel, I can measure incremental outcomes that my campaign drew across control and expose. So this is a philosophy of Lyft, and every tool that we're building, for marketers, we are kind of taking this philosophy and putting it to use. So I talked about some of the brand metrics that we measure. It's similar to any other metric that you would measure in the offline world. And sales outcomes. Because we have a Pixel and SDK implemented, if it is, then we can actually look at the path to purchase. We can also look at offline. So if you have a offline channel in addition, so if you're a bank and you're having people walking into the bank or calling in and purchasing, opening accounts. So what you can do is we have something called an offline conversion tool. So we do exactly the same thing where we have a control and a test holdout. And post the campaign, we can take data from the CRM or any other database that you have, which can have a mobile number or an email ID, can bump it up against the Facebook data, and then you can distribute the people across test and control and see if there's a difference. So even if it's an offline event, such as, say, a Big Bazaar sale event or anything else that you're running as an offline sale event, and you're running Facebook campaigns ahead of the sale event, if you set up a holdout during the campaign, post the event, you can go back and bump up this data and look for incremental difference between test and control. So the concept of lift that I talked about is applicable both on online and on offline, simply because we're able to match people back, and the database is so big that we have a few billion people on Facebook that the chances are very high that you'll get a good match rate of the consumers that walked into your store. I talked about conversion lift, which is basically sales outcomes such as add to cart, view content, sale events. So we can do an incremental test. So we can actually say how much of your sales attributed from came from your advertising and people who viewed the ad. We're also developing a bunch of tools that allow you to do multi-touch attribution that we talked about. So we're using the Facebook identity as a core and allowing advertisers to use that to also track how other publishers are doing. So what we need clients to do is to tag all their other digital publishers, and then you can use the Facebook identity to allocate credit and move from last click to any other model that you would like to choose. We also have market mix models that we build for clients who are also investing heavily on online media versus Facebook. So if there is a significant spend that you're doing on Facebook or digital, say which crosses 5, 10, 15% of your overall budget, and you've done that for a period of time, especially for non-CPG businesses where you have access to sales data or traffic data, you can run these statistical models that allow you to attribute the spend to the outcome and say what's the incremental that each of your media contributed. We have cross-media studies, we have MMM, so any tool that is out there the market is comfortable with, we kind of work with them to deploy that tool and provide the Facebook data that they need to complete the exercise. That's all I had. So hopefully this was useful in kind of just introducing you to the concepts that we use, the philosophy at Facebook in terms of measurement, and at least introduce you to some of the tools that are available on Facebook to help you measure both on Facebook and off Facebook. And we're continuing to build this. I think you'll hear a lot more in the coming months around how we're using our identity and measurement solutions, both on the brand side and on the performance side, to help you measure not only on Facebook, but all publishers, and through the funnel, including audience outcomes, brand metrics, sales outcomes, and so on.